the message goes forth, that the Holy Spirit spring up in me and speak through and in and around me and for me, Father God. Decrease all of me and let it be none of me but you, Lord. I thank you right now, Father God, as your word goes forth, it goes forth blessed on receptive hearts and on receptive ears, ready to hear what you have to say for their life, Father God. I thank you that each get it at their level of understanding that you have given them, Father God. I thank you right now, Lord, that it makes them get zealous and they want to go out and study your word and know more about you, Father God. I thank you right now, Lord. Speak with my mouth, Lord. I thank you right now. Think with my mind, Father God. And I just thank you, Lord, that my words don't get tied, Lord, but they go forth and accomplish what you have set them to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So when I was before you last, which would have been a week and 2 weeks ago, we went through part two of the promised land, inherit the promised land, and God told us a couple things of what we needed to do. And we got through four of them, so we're going to try to get through all of them this morning. Amen. So the first thing he had told us last time was entering our new season that we needed to get alone and still. And I want to give honor to everyone in here. Amen. I want to give honor to my pastor, who's the head of this house. Amen. This house of prayer, amen. She is a studier. She is not just a hearer of the word, but she is also a doer of this word. She lives this word. And as we said on Wednesday, she's true to this. So I just thank her for all that God has called her to be. God bless the children, bless all the other leaders in the congregation, and last but not least, my husband, who's in the back, amen, who had a chance to fellowship with his friends, amen. It was a lifelong friendship. They've been friends for over 20 years. They were able to get back together and enjoy. So as we know, there's joy in the Lord, amen. And I just thank God for that they have safe travels on their way back home, going their separate directions. So let's jump right in. So last week we said get still and get alone. And he gave us the example of Joshua right before the battle of Jericho, amen. And then the second thing was disobedience will cost you everything. So he said, and your sins was going to fall on all that are attached to you. And he used that in the example of Achan. Amen. And then the third thing he said to us was God is going to turn it all around for our good. And he used that in the battle of Ai when they fleeted and ran, and they used that when they came back to fight them as a strategy in order to make them win. Amen. So the fourth thing we said was don't make a move without God. And he gave us the example of the people of Gideon and their deceit. And they acted like they traveled far. And Joshua wound up making a covenant with them that he wouldn't hurt them or whatever, even though God had gave them their land. And as we discussed last time, they were bigger than Ai and all of that. So he had to wind up honoring that covenant, because the Bible tells us when you make a covenant with God, it's better that you don't even make any promises than to make something and don't keep your word. Amen. Unlike this generation, your word means nothing. God, your word, what's spoken out of your mouth means something. You have some authority. So they wind up being their footstool, and that was chapter 9, verses 22 through 27. They wind up serving them. It said unto this day. Amen. So now we leave off there, because now all the tribes have heard around that Gideon had made this deal with Joshua. And that brings us to chapter 10 and verse 5. We'll read, therefore, the five kings of the Amorites, the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, the king of Jarmuth, and the king of Lachish, and the king of Eglon, gathered themselves together and went up, they and all their hosts, and encamped before Gibeon and made war against it. So now they're upset, because they're like, okay, now you done made this covenant with them, and you think, and of course we saw in earlier verses that the reason Gibeon was a huge city and their walls were fortified, and not just that, meaning tried and tested, they were also men of war. They were good men and fighters. So what the devil meant for bad, God turned around for you good, like we said. So here we go. So now he says right here in 6, and the men of Gibeon sent unto Joshua. So now they go unto Joshua, and they're like, Joshua, listen, you made this covenant with us, and we need you to come help us fight now. You got to come and help us fight. And Joshua's like, okay, we're going to come and help you fight. God tells Joshua, do not be dismayed. I'm going to deliver them into your hands. I got your back. I got your sides, your front, every which way. So then it goes to 10, verse 10. And the Lord discomforted them before Israel and slew them with a great slaughter in at Gibeon and chased them along the way that goeth up in Bithrom and smote them from Azkash and Makeda. And it came to pass, as they fled from before Israel and were in going down to Bethoron, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven and upon them Azkai, and they died. And there were more which died with hailstones, and they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. So more died from God throwing down hailstones than they actually killed on the battlefield. So how many know God will fight your battles? You don't have to say nothing. He'll fight your battles. Amen? Amen. Because that's what he did. He knew, they knew God was with him. So he killed more than whatever they could do themselves. And he goes on here. And what God had me lead me to this, because I almost missed it, was this next level, number five we got to do. It comes with much prayer, much fasting, and much belief. Amen. Amen. So the example he gave me was in verses 12 and 14 of 10. And it says, then Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel, he said in the sight of Israel, son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun sits still in the midst of heaven and has not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like it that before it or after it that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man. For the Lord fought for Israel. Amen. So with much prayer, much fasting, and much belief we have. Joshua had God with him. He was able to speak. And it says in his words that no day did the Lord listen to a man. Amen. But this day. And so God hears us. We know in the New Testament, amen, that he hears us because Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. So now we have access to him. Amen. And he's able to hear us. So from that, he tells us that you have authority. The Bible tells us that we have authority. And you must speak with your authority. Amen. I'll back this up, put it in your notes. I'm going to go over it. I won't have you guys turn to it, but Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Amen. And we know that power is the Holy Spirit. Amen. That God left for us, that worketh within us. Then it goes to Luke chapter 10, verse 19. It says, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Amen. So you got power. Stop walking around like you ain't got no power in the Lord. Amen. Amen. Luke 9:1 says again, then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. Amen. So God is giving you power. You have access to that power. So when you go to him praying, he said, come to his throne boldly. You're asking him, because as we sung this morning, I believe that he'll do that just what he says. Amen. It all ties together when it comes to the Lord, because you have to be a believer and not a doubter. You have to be a doer and not just a hearer. I can't hear these words and not put them and activate in my life. It's sad to see when a Christian can sit in church and you can hear these words and you can be around the truth but never receive that truth. Because God wants you to live free from bondage so that you can go break other people free. Have you seen anybody in jail let out someone else in jail? No. They may break together and say, we're getting out of here. But I can't go get the key and let you out if I'm bound myself. Amen? Amen. So he wants you to be free so that you can go free, help free somebody else. And what does the Bible tell us? Because who the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we got to have that authority. Amen? God said it. Joshua spoke. You got to have that faith. Amen? Amen? Now, we'll keep going because now it goes on. They go. They fight all these kings. And as we read earlier in our responsive reading, the five kings flee. They run. They go hide in this cave. And so Joshua, funny, because he's like, well, go ahead and put some stones around and put some guards in front of this cave, and they're going to stay there while we go kill everybody else. So they went ahead and kill everybody else. And then what we read today in 22 through 25 was them coming back, and now they rolled the stones away, and they did unto them what he told them. And he told them in verse 25, and Joshua said unto them, fear not nor be dismayed. Be strong and of good courage. Isn't that what the Lord told him in chapter 1? For thus shall the Lord do to all your enemies against whom you fight.
So he tells them, don't be afraid, don't be dismayed, because we got more battles, and this is what God's going to do to all your enemies, so get ready. So we go on, and it starts going on in the latter part of 10 with Joshua's conquest, and all that. He went to Makeda and fought them, the king of Jericho. He took, it says in the Bible, put to the sword. So he put to the sword Libni, put to the sword Lachish, Eglon, Hebron. He took them all. Debar, he took them all. So then 40, it says, Joshua smote all the country hillsides south of the vale and the springs, and all the kings. He left none remaining, but utterly destroyed all that breathed, as the Lord God of Israel commanded. So he did what God told him to do. And in sixth thing he told us, you got to be able to take direction. You got to be able to take direction. And the seventh thing he said, and it ties in together, only what you do for God will last. Amen. So I want you guys to turn to Joshua chapter 11, verse 15. And in 11 and 15, we'll read this together. Okay. So this is the example God gave me. Now it says, as the Lord commanded Moses, his servant, so did Moses command Joshua.
All right.
And so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. Amen. You got to be able to take direction. The Bible told us that Joshua was under Moses. Amen. And he followed him willingly. Amen. And he followed him. He was one of those two spies, him and Caleb, who came back and was like, we can take this land, when God was ready to promote them into the promised land. But they, the children of Israel, wasn't ready. Amen. So you got Moses here. Only what you do for God will last, because Moses is all through the book of Joshua. It mentions Moses all the time. Even as they dish out land and territory, it goes back to who Moses said, what Moses spoke. So understand, everything you do, only what you do for God will last. Only what you do for God will last. Moses did Exodus. Moses wrote the first five books of this, of the Bible. And he did all this, but it was for God. So that's why Moses' name is still around. Because of God. Amen. What he did for him, what he did for God lasted. Joshua put those to the sword who God commanded Moses, as it says here. So you got to be able to take direction. There's a chain of command. As we can see, the Lord spoke to Moses. So it started with God. He spoke to Moses. And then Moses spoke to Joshua. And Joshua spoke to the people. Amen. So this is over time. So understand that even the stuff that you go through, the Bible tells us some things are meant for you to see. And then some things are meant for your children to see. So I may be laying groundwork. Some things I'm going to see. I'm going to see God's blessing. But we may be, as parents, laying groundwork for things for you to reap those benefits later on. Amen? Which is what Joshua was doing. Because as we can see later on, even in Judges, they had to continue going on with what Joshua had said. Amen? So now God says, so that is six. Put it in your note. Number six. You got to be able to take direction in this new season. And you, only what you do for God will last. So don't get bound up in what you think you can do, but what God says. Amen. His will. Amen. So now we go on. They go on. They destroy other people. They come to. And one thing I wanted to know is, like, because as you start going on and see, a lot of them brought the fight to them. They didn't really have to go and take the fight. And I wanted to know exactly why, because it was like kings were gathering up to get together with them. I suggest you go back and study these Bible, this battles, because it's very good. There's a lot of meat in there that God wants you to have, but you got to be sitting out with your notes and really studying. So in chapter 11, verse 20, it says, for it was the Lord who hardened their hearts, that they should come against Israel in battle, and that he might destroy them utterly, and that they might have no favor, but that he might destroy them as the Lord commanded Moses. Amen. So Joshua is fulfilling what God told Moses. Amen. And what those conquered things was supposed to be. So it was God who hardened their hearts. Amen. Who waxed their hearts. And in order to have everything set out to do what it was supposed to do. So like we said, his word would not return void. It's going to accomplish what it set out to accomplish. Amen. Amen. So now it goes through in chapter 12, talks about Moses and the lands that he conquered prior to on the other side of Jordan. And then it goes back to the lands that Joshua conquered. And then in 13, it was something that stuck out, because God says to him, he's like, now, Joshua, you start to get old. Joshua gets old. He says, now Joshua was old and stricken in years, and the Lord said unto him, thou art old and stricken in years, and there still remaineth much land to be possessed. And so he tells them exactly what to do with the land. Because he goes before them and he's like, listen, you're getting old. There's still land that still needs to be possessed. Because remember, they were at war for a while. And it says Joshua was at war with them for a long time, some of these kings. And you can go back and study that yourself. I'm not for the sake of time. But he was at war. And so now he's like, you're entering in this rest. You're getting old, and there's still stuff that needs to be conquered. Amen. There's still stuff that you have to do. So he tells them, well, listen, this is what you're going to do. There's still about a couple tribes that still haven't, because he tells them the borders, and he goes through verses 2 on down. He tells them the border that needs to be there, that needs to still be conquered, over the Philistines, over the ocean, all that. And then he says in 7:13, now therefore divide this land for an inheritance unto the 9 tribes and the half tribe of Manasseh. Now he tells them, go tell those 9 tribes, this is what you're going to do. You're going to divide the land, and this is what's going to happen, because they're going to individually have to go conquer that. Amen. So it starts going through at this point, breaking down the inheritance of all these tribes. And I won't go through that, but there's a couple things that stuck out. Now, number 8, God tells us, let go and let God. And we have not because we ask not. Now, I want you to put this in your notes, number chapter 14, verse 24. And I'll read this verse. It says, but my servant Caleb, because he had a different spirit with him and hath followed me fully, him will I bring into the land whereinto he went, meaning everything his foot touched, and his seed shall possess it. Now, this is God talking to Moses at this time in Numbers, telling him about Caleb because he had a different spirit. Who is Caleb? We said Caleb was one of those 2 spies who came back. It was Joshua and Caleb, out of the 12 that Moses sent out in Numbers, who said, tell me, and everyone else was like, there's giants, we can't take this land. Only Caleb and Joshua was like, no, we can do it. God's with us, we can do it. And it's funny because God knows him. You don't hear about Caleb until back here. You hear about him in Numbers, but you don't hear about it again until we get here. And the reason being is because God knew who Caleb was, as he said in Numbers, because Caleb had a different spirit on him. He had my spirit. He had a different spirit. He had God's spirit on him. And he said, we can do. And you'll see who Caleb is in verse 6 of 14. So it says, then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh and Kazai said unto them, thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh. And that's what we just read in Numbers. 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh to espy out the land, when he went to spy with Joshua, right? And I brought him in the word again, as it was in my heart. God deals with the heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt, meaning they scared them. Remember, the other ones were like, we can't do it, so much so they wanted to kill Caleb and Joshua, right? So he's saying, he's reminding. Sometimes you got to remind people. And he says, nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land where thy foot hath trodden shall be thine inheritance, and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord God. And so you have not because you ask not. He had to go and say, hold up, hold up. While you dishing out land, remember what I have done. I haven't asked him nothing. You ain't heard Caleb ask nothing. He went, he fought, and he did what he was supposed to do. And then he comes back. Remember that word that God gave me? Everything that God gave Moses, and Moses said that my foot, the land I spot, is going to be mine. I'm ready. I'm ready now. Amen. Amen. So now it says, we have not because we ask not. He had to ask. And he still had work to be due, as we can see. Because then in 13, Joshua blessed him and gave him that land. Because he had to tell him, he was like, listen, I'm old, but I still got fight in me. Amen? So he tells him, hey, listen. Now, therefore, he tells him, give me this mountain. He goes on in verse 12. Verse 13, it says, and Joshua blessed him and gave unto Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Hebron, for an inheritance. Hebron, therefore, became the inheritance of Caleb, son of Jephunneh, the Kezites, unto this day, because he wholeheartedly followed the Lord God of Israel. Amen. So he didn't have to do it. He followed everything that God had told him to do. Amen. He didn't doubt. He followed it. Amen. So now he goes on dishing out more land and more land. I won't go over that. I want you guys to study that for yourself. But we get to 17. All right. And I stop here because I was like, okay, let me find out. I want to know about God a little bit more. And I'm looking, because if you skip over some of this stuff, you'll miss it. But if you go to chapter 17, verses 3 through 6, we'll find out. Guess what? This is why they're called the half-tribe of Manasseh. I was wondering, as Pastor said, she inquisitive. I'm inquisitive too, because I'm asking, like, what? God had me all the way looking back at the three children, the three boys who got out that ark in order to bring me back here, and he didn't give me the answer until this morning. Amen. So he says, amen. So he goes in here, verse 17, chapter 17 and verse 3. But Zipporah, the son of Hephrah, the son of Gilgad, and the son of Machshor, the son of Manasseh, and had no sons, but daughters. And these are the names of his daughters: Mahlai, Noah, Hagla, Milcah, and Tarzah. And they came near before Eleazar the priest, and before Joshua the son of Nun, and before the princes, saying, "The Lord commanded Moses to give us an inheritance amongst our brethren. Therefore, according to the commandment of the Lord, he gave them an inheritance among the brethren of their father. And there fell 10 portions to Manasseh beside the land of Gilgal and the other side of Jordan." So one side settled on Jordan. That's why it's called the half-tribe. One side was on one side of the Jordan, the east, and the other was on the other side of Jordan. So they had split up. And that's why it's called the half-tribe of Manasseh, because they didn't settle together. Some on this side, some on that side. And it's funny here that God gave them land. How revolutionary that was as far as women go. Because a lot of people say God don't use women. But he does. If you look at Esther, you look at Ruth, you go back, he uses women. And he has no respect to person is what the Bible tells us. So here he goes. They dished out. In order to keep this in, they gave it to the women. They gave this land to the women. Amen. And it said on 6, because the daughters of Manasseh had an inheritance amongst his sons, and the rest of Manasseh's sons had the land of Gilgad. So they gave them land. Amen. And these were women. Back in those times, that was big. Amen. So now it brings us here. Number 9, he says, there should be no hesitation in operating in your faith. Amen. So let's read right here. Now in 18. We'll go 18, 1 through 3. The whole congregation of the children of Israel assembled together at Shiloh. Now, Shiloh was like the worship place. That's where the altar was to the Lord. That was the worship place for all the tribes. And set up the tabernacle of congregation there. Congregation meaning just a whole group of people. And the land was subdued before them. And there remained among the children of Israel 7 tribes, which had not yet received their inheritance. And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, now remember, let's pause here. Remember, we just discussed, God told him what to do with those 9 tribes who hadn't received their land, told them to go ahead and divide up because they were going to have to conquer it, right? So now here we go, because there's 7 tribes who still haven't inherited their land. So he tells them, Joshua 3, said unto the children of Israel, how long are ye slack to go possess the land which the Lord God your father hath given you? How long are you going to wait? There has to be no hesitation in operating your faith. When God gives you a word, you going to sit on it? How long are you going to wait before you go take what God told you is yours? Because the Bible tells us we take it by force. How long are we going to wait? How long? How long are you going to wait on that ministry God told you to have? How long are you going to wait on that promotion that you're supposed to be going to ask for? Amen? How long are you going to wait? And to do what God told you to do. It's all resting on you. He's giving you the blessing, but you don't want to go inherit it. You don't want to go take it. There still has to be work that needs to be done. You can't be hasty. Faith without works is dead. So they got the land, but they haven't done the works yet. So where are they at operating their faith? And they come with excuses. And they come with excuses. So what Joshua winds up telling them to do, listen, we're going to cast lots. You go peep out this land, and then we're going to cast a lot, and we'll divide it up. And they still had to go take it, because he wasn't doing it for them. Amen? So now, number 10, he tells us, the last shall come first, and the first shall come last. And we get to 19, and we see where, as we read this morning, where Joshua gets his inheritance. When they had made an end of dividing, that's in verse 49 of chapter 19, of the land of inheritance off their coast, the children of Israel gave an inheritance to Joshua, the son of Nun among them. According to the word of the Lord, they gave him the city which he had asked, even to Ma. So they wind up giving him all this stuff. They wind up giving him the city that he had asked for. And God says in his word in Luke chapter 22, verse 26, that we need, it says, but ye shall not be so, But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that do serve. So meaning those who have rulers who are supposed to be also servers. You got to be humble in this new season. You got to be humble in this new season. And God will give you what it was. Joshua went and fought all these battles, and he still had to remain humble until his reward came. Amen. He had to dish out land and stuff until his reward came. Sometimes people get up and they get these titles and they believe they're better than or more than. And God said, no, you're the least of these. Even the leader should be least of these. As Jesus said, as he cleaned the disciples' feet, humble. You got to humble yourself, because it takes humility to lead people. It takes humility to pray for people in spite of. It takes humility to bless those that curse you. It takes humility to lead without having anything, because at the end of the day, your heart and your call, you have to answer to God for all the flock and all those he sent to you. And as Jesus said, all those my Father sent to me, have I lost none. Amen?
Amen.
So we have to have a heart of humility in this new season. You can't get haughty, meaning hot. You can't get fresh, thinking I'm all that and a bag of chips with soda on the side too. You can't get that way.
Amen.
It's God who does everything.
Amen.
Amen. Which brings us to 11. And it says, God is the ultimate prize. That's what you have to remember. And we go as the example of the Levites. The Levites didn't get an inheritance amongst the children of Israel. The Levites, it says that God, them being ministers of God, basically was their inheritance. They didn't get an inheritance amongst them. We can read that in chapter 18 and verse 7. It says, but the Levites have no part among you, for the priesthood of the Lord is their inheritance. And Gad and Reuben and the half tribe of Manasseh have received their inheritance beyond Jordan in the east with Moses the servant the Lord gave them. So what they wind up doing for them was giving them parishes, or giving them, towns, lands around. Because he winds up telling them, what God winds up telling them is, there's everything is done in decency and order. And right as we were talking this morning, what he winds up telling them is this. You got to set designated cities for those who, basically the law, there were cities of refuge for those who accidentally kill someone, not on purpose, it's an accident. They accidentally kill someone to be able to go without having cause and save or whatever. And when I was reading it, I'm like, well, why would you do that? And then Holy Spirit quickened me to understand that it protects you as well as the person who wants to get revenge on you. Because remember, these are all followers of God. So lest I not cause my brother to sin. If I accidentally kill somebody, by accident, all those who are attached to that person want to come get revenge on me. So you got to go and hide somewhere in order for the law to happen. So there's a process. There's a due process, as we say, that has to go forth. Order, right? Then the other thing with the Levites, what he did after they did the towns of refuge, they set around those towns that were basically devoted, where those Levites were staying. Remember, they were of royal priesthood. And remember we said back in those days, you couldn't go like we can now. That's how much of a privilege it is for you to be able to access God, because they couldn't. They had to go to the priest. They would tie a rope around his waist in hopes that he will come back out.
Amen.
They will give their sacrificial, whatever, he will take it beyond the veil. There was a veil. Beyond the veil, because everybody couldn't be in the presence of the Lord. As we saw with the ark when it passed over. Amen. All those had to stay a certain amount away from it. So they would go in, they would sacrifice, they would do whatever, and take your prayer in hopes that they will come out. What the rope was for is that if they weren't living holy and right, they would have to drag them out by that rope, because they would have been struck down. Amen. So now, this is that royal priesthood. So we got to remember, as in all that getting, get a good understanding. And what's the good understanding? It takes us back. Amen. To Luke chapter 10. Now, we read 19, right? If you guys remember, what was Luke 19? What did it say? Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by no means hurt you. But see, that's why you got to study the whole Bible. Because then the next verse, chapter 10, 20 says, However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven.
Amen.
So you got to remember, God is the ultimate prize.
Yes, yes.
Not stuff, not things, because they were made rich through this time. They got gold, they got silver, they got everything. The Bible starts to talk about it in here. Everything that was allotted, they had all their stuff. And that's each tribe. These are thousands of people. Hundreds of thousands of people, really. Each tribe got their stuff. But what you got to remember? God is the ultimate prize. Thank it's the God God you serve. God. It's not all the other stuff. And all that getting, get a good understanding. And it's like, while you adding all this stuff to you, add you some wisdom and understanding. Yeah. To know that God is God and God alone. Amen. And it's happy because as easy as he gives, he can take it. The Bible tells us in Psalms, he put it down one to promote another. Amen. Amen. So you have to remember to remain humble. Yeah. You got to remember in this time, in this due season, that God, you'll reap if you faint not. You will reap if you faint not. Mm-hmm. Don't faint. Don't let your heart get heavy looking at the battle and not remembering who you serve. We are glad because why? Why we sing and why we praise and we talk about God. We talk about God all the time and we say Satan can't have your praise. We sing in this morning. Why? Because we know our names are written in that book.
Yes.
That's the ultimate prize. My soul is going to be with God.
Uh-huh.
That's the ultimate prize. Not everything on this earth that I can see, feel, touch, and taste. Those five senses they teach you as you're growing up, the five senses, that means nothing when it comes to spiritual.
All right.
It means nothing. Because greater is he. Greater is he than he that is in the world. That's right. Stuff. You can't even take it with you when you die. They can throw it in the grave with you. Yes. But can you enjoy it? No.
Amen.
Hello, aren't they digging up pyramids and stuff with stuff in them?
Say so.
Stuff in them? Amen. Couldn't take it with them. You can't take it. And all that getting, as you collecting, and all your getting, get you a good understanding.
Amen.
Pray for wisdom. Amen? Amen.
Amen.
Now, we go on to trust God completely. And that's in chapter 21, almost done, 21 verse 43 through 45. And it says, and the Lord God, and the Lord gave unto Israel all the land which he swore to give unto their fathers, and they possessed it and dwelt therein. And the Lord gave them rest, meaning they didn't fight. The Lord gave them rest round about, according to all that he swore unto their fathers. And there stood not a man of all their enemies before them. The Lord delivered all their enemies into their hand.
All right.
There failed not aught of any good thing which the Lord had spoken unto the house of Israel. All came to pass. So not one thing he spoke, not one good thing he spoke to them, it all came to pass. Amen? Amen. So now that you're in this land and you're inhabitants and you got rest, can someone say drama?
Drama.
As Pastor loves the quote, is it Paul or is it Peter? Paul, as he says, as I try to do good, evil is always around. Always around. So here we go, because now they're in the promised land, right? And we're going to go. Number 13. Capture Satan's every fiery dart. Now 13. Now here we go. They are all got rest. We're in chapter 22. And he says to them. Now I have to give you a little history. If you go back to Joshua chapter 1 verse 14. Now we talked about that half tribe of Manasseh. We talked about that. But I want you to understand why this happened. So in chapter 1 verse 14 it says, your wives, your little ones, and your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side of Jordan. But you shall pass before your brethren armed, and all the mighty men of valor, and help them, until the Lord God give your brethren rest, and he hath given as he has given you. And they also have possessed the land which the Lord your God giveth unto them. Then ye shall return unto the land of the possession and enjoy it, which Moses the Lord's servant gave you on this day, on this side of the Jordan toward the sun rising. And they wind up answering him in 16, 17, and 18, saying they will go with him. Now, they are still, as we said when we went over this, the first time I came before you talking about Joshua, we said that was what God had said. Are you willing to make yourself uncomfortable for someone else's victory? Are you willing to make yourself uncomfortable for someone else's joy? Are you willing to make yourself uncomfortable for someone else's soul? Because as we said, we go out and minister to people, and I'm shy, so I don't want to talk to somebody. Are you willing to make yourself uncomfortable because you don't know whether they're going home and blow their brains out? You don't know.
Amen.
You don't know. You really don't know. Am I willing to be uncomfortable for God's will? Because that's what they had to do. They had to leave. Moses had gave them that land. They had to leave all that and go on the other side of Jordan. Remember when they crossed the Jordan River and all of that? They had to go with them. Left all their wives and their cattle, like we just read in chapter 1. Left all their wives and their cattle, and they had to go over with them in order to fight. So they've been fighting this whole time. This whole time we've been going, these people have been with them fighting. Now they have entered rest, as we just read. So now this is what we're about to see. So Joshua called the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half tribe of Manasseh. And we said reason why they half tribes, some settled on this side of the Jordan, some settled on that. So the ones that settled on the other side of the Jordan, these are the ones he's calling. And he said unto them, ye have kept all that Moses, the servant Lord, commanded you, and you have obeyed my voice and all that I commanded you. Ye have not left your brethren these many days until this day, but you have kept charge of the commandment of that the Lord your God gave you, basically. And now the Lord your God hath given rest unto your brethren, as he promised them. Therefore now return ye and get unto your tents and unto your land and your possession, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you on the other side of Jordan. So he tells them, listen, you have listened to everything I have said. You have done everything you have promised to do. You kept God's commandment. As he said, you can't have rest. You got to go help fight the men of war. You left your woman over there. Now you can go back and return to your wives, your children, and your livestock and all that and have rest, right? So he winds up blessing them. And he says to them, listen, make sure you keep the commandments of the Lord. Don't you forget. So now they're going to go ahead and travel. So verses 10, what they wind up doing, because I kept telling y'all, like, when we were talk outside of this, I kept telling, like, I was wondering why they built this altar, and I had to go back and study. And then I understand why. Because remember, they're on the other side of the Jordan. So now in 10 it says, and they came unto the borders of the Jordan that are in the land of Canaan, and the children of Reuben and the children of Gad and the half tribe of Manasseh built an altar by Jordan, a great altar to see. And the children, verse 12, and the children of Israel heard of it. So now they built this altar. And mind you, the only altar was where we just said? In Shiloh. That was the worship place. So now they built this great altar. And the people, the children of Israel, heard about this altar. And it says the congregation. So they hear about this altar and they're like, hold on. I know y'all are not going back to that desert days, worshiping other gods after we just did all this. So they hear about it in verse 12. We're going to read in 12. And when the children of Israel heard of it, the whole congregation of the children of Israel gathered themselves together at Shiloh to go up to go war against them. So now they hear about them building this altar and they're ready for war. Because they're like, this don't make no sense. What's going on? How are you going to build this altar? Because remember, altar was supposed to be for worship of the Lord. So they're thinking something different. That's why you have to capture Satan's every fiery dart, right? And all that getting, get an understanding. And the Bible also says, lean not to your own understanding. Because that's what they were doing here. They were leaning to their own understanding. So then it says, as they went out, they wind up going unto those children of Manasseh. They wind up going to them. They saw them. They're like, listen, we ain't even got the stench of aching off of us yet. We ain't even got aching off of us. So, and we still are suffering and haven't been cleansed for what happened in Numbers. In Numbers chapter 25, verses 1 through 13, when that plague came down on them. They're like, we still ain't been cleansed of that. Amen? So that's in 15 through 20. So he says to them, we ain't been cleansed of that. And now you guys are going against what God has told you. You already in sin. Like, you already in sin. They're coming to him like, brother, what's going on? Like, now we got to kill you because we ain't trying to have what happened to Achan on all of us again. That's not going to happen. We're not trying to go through that. So then they come and answer them. They wind up answering them in chapter 22 and verse 21. It says, they say to them in 21, then the children of Reuben and the children of Gad and the half tribe of Manasseh answered and said unto the heads of thousands of Israel, the Lord God of gods, the Lord God of gods, he knoweth. And Israel he shall know, if it be in rebellion or of transgression against the Lord, save us not this day, that we may build us an altar to turn from following the Lord. They're saying, we ain't built this altar to not follow the Lord. We built the altar. Our heart was in the right place. We built this altar in order for it, in verse 27, for it may be witness between us and you and our generations after us, that we might do the service of the Lord before him with the burnt offerings and with our sacrifices and with our peace offerings, that your children may not say to our children in time to come, ye have no part in the Lord. Meaning, we have promise in this inheritance that God gave because we're on the other side of the Jordan. We're going to build this altar here before we cross over to the other side of Jordan, so that when future generations come and they see this and they may say, who are these people on this side? We can go to war against them. They wanted to remind them that, listen, we are partaking in God's promised land as well. So I wanted to build this for you so you can know, your children's children know, that God is with us too. And so that's why he left it. Why he brought that out to me? Because understanding. You got to have understanding. When we go against certain things, capturing Satan's every fiery dart, when you're in ministry and when you're working, you can see it on work, you see it in school. Everybody comes with from their level of understanding. So in that, you got to ask God for understanding. That's why we pray before we even talk about certain things. Let's pray. Why? So that God can give us all understanding. Because you got to be able to capture Satan's every fiery dart. They were ready to go to war. And had they went to war, Satan would have won. They would have been fighting amongst themselves and not even knowing over a misunderstanding. Because their heart was in the right place, they were ready to worship God. But because of what it looked like to someone else, they're ready to go to war. We can't be moved by what we see. Amen? And you got to give someone a chance to correct it. You got to give someone a chance to get it right. You got to give someone a chance so that you both can have understanding, which is what they did. And then it goes on and it says in 30, and as it goes on, that they wind up being happy with their answer and they were satisfied and all was made well and they all took their rest. But they were ready to go war against each other just that quick. Satan tries to get in. So as you're in this new promised land, don't give the devil a foothold, not even a little bit. Every misunderstanding, you're going to have to bring it together. Every misunderstanding, you're going to have to come together and get it right and get it. Because guess what? It can lead so many astray. So many astray. Amen? Amen. Amen. Y'all getting quiet. I know I'm talking right. Verse 14. All right. So now the 14th thing and the last thing in our close. It says, in all that getting, after you're done, they praise God. So now Joshua is getting older in age, as it says in verse 23. And it came to pass a long time after the Lord had given rest unto Israel from all the enemies around. And Joshua called for Israel and their elders and their heads and for their judges and the officers and said unto them, I am old and stricken in age. And ye have seen all the Lord God have done and all the nations because of you. And God, he had fought for you. So he tells them, you've seen everything that God has done. You've seen all the stuff that God has brought us to. You've seen everything that happened. I want to make sure that you continue with your covenant. I want to make sure. Basically, he was getting ready to die, his last will and testament, basically. And he tells them, listen, continue to move towards God. I want an oath from you saying you're going to continue to follow God. God has given us rest. He has fought our battles. You've seen all that he's done from AI on down. He wants us now continue to worship him. Continue to live according to the way God has called you to live. And they say to him, we will continue to fear the Lord. As they go on in chapter 24, he says to him, we will continue to fear the Lord. We'll continue. And he's like, listen, I ain't trying to hear that. I want to hear from you truly. Are you going to continue to follow God? And they say, yes, we're going to continue. So Joshua says that he was satisfied with their answer at that point. And he tells them, in that, he tells them, Joshua said unto the people in 27 of 24, behold, this stone shall be a witness unto us, for it hath heard all the words the Lord which he has spoken unto us. It shall be therefore a witness unto you, lest ye deny your God. So Joshua let the people depart, every man unto his inheritance. So he had called all the leaders and he said to them, listen, this stone is going to be a witness. Remember, they had left stones in Jordan to remember. So they had little rememberings for them as they crossed certain things. And he said, this stone was bearing witness that you, to this day, you said, you're going to serve God. God going to be your God. And he said, because Joshua tells him, that's where that verse comes from. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It's right here in Joshua. And he said right there that this be. And the Bible tells us that if you don't praise him, rocks will cry out. So that rock was bearing witness unto them. So as we go, as I close, the last thing in this is remember and continue to praise God. Praise God with how you live. Praise God with how you speak. Praise God with how you act in all your being. He said, in him we live, move, and have our being. With all your being, you want to continue to give God praise. Because he gets praise not just from day to day in church, praising him in worship. Worship also is how you act in school, how you act on your job. Because everything you're doing is supposed to be shining your light to bring people out of darkness. Amen? Amen. May God continue to bless you. Father God, we just thank you for this word that's went forth, Father God. I thank you right now, Lord, that they're able to go back and study it and really digest it into what you would have them to know, that the Holy Spirit begin to water and begin to speak like never before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.